know, I'm still wondering what the organisers of this forum had in mind when they came up with this title of my presentation. It is very much like a licence given to out-of-dinner speakers. Say whatever you like, provided it is entertaining. Unfortunately, the sweet wine of success seems thus far to have eluded me. If I had possessed the wisdom of Solomon, I would never have had anything to do with Lady Grasses. But due to my lack of discretion, I can relate to plenty of woes. So, perhaps in a macabre sort of way, you might find this presentation entertaining. In 1977, when an unsolicited Commonwealth grant of $100,000 became available for a provided proposal on weed management in Cleveland Conservation Park, I worked with Dr. Tim Fatchin in preparing a proactive program to replace weeds with a native perennial grass in the Themida Triangle. With no knowledge of how the species should be harvested and propagated, I spent less than 10 of the $100,000 available in purchasing two hamsicles, one for myself and a second for our council employee in this photo. I must confess that his sickle was much more active than mine. Sheaves of the hand-harvested columns were taken to a site in the park located on Long Ridge, where the seed-bearing columns were laid out as a thatch on the ground. I had the notion that offering a sickle to any of our council workers to do a day's work harvesting Themida was not going to win me too many friends. Could this grass be better harvested with a tractor-powered forage harvester? And if so, would the severing of the seed awns impair its establishment? So we put some corn through a chaff cutter to find out. Here we are well into winter, with plenty of established weeds but no sign of any Themida seedlings. Nobody had told me that summer growing grasses are more likely to germinate in spring rather than autumn or winter. In an effort to extend my options, I sprayed off a competing winter wheat growth. If I can get this small patch of grass to germinate, there is huge scope for establishing it over the hill's face zone, where previous constant stocking has decimated the natural grassy ground cover. Not much chance, though, with the growth progress we are currently making. It is now December, and there's still no sign of any Themida seedlings. In desperation, we decide to burn the site. Returning to Long Ridge in January after Christmas break, I'm excited to find numerous grass seedlings in most of the area that was burnt. The question is it Themida, or just the second germination of wild oats that abound in this location? A phone call to David Simon at the Waite Institute assures me that small white hairs at the base of these leaves is confirmation that we have successfully propagated Themida. Interestingly, not one seedling was found where charred corms were spread over the site and likewise burnt. Seems like we have to be content with wielding sickles rather than driving forage harvesters. 8 years on in our program to revegetate the hill's face zone, we have only progressed from sickles to brush cutters and pitchforks. But you don't have to be the operator of an impressive forage harvester to display management potential. The person operating that brush cutter is now the CEO of the Tiktu Gully Council. You know, dedicated assistance from the staff in some very tedious work did produce enduring results. Over 30 years on, this re-established Themida is still persisting in the Green Hill Recreation Park. My real problem in those early days was not so much in achieving satisfactory results in native grass establishment, but getting sufficient labour just prior to the Christmas holidays to achieve those results. Here in 1987, a streak of my inherent madness is revealed. I managed to convince my local Animal and Plant Control Board, along with the State Commission, to agree to borrowing money to purchase this very expensive bench tool carrier that I equipped with a custom-built seed harvester based on the design conceived in the ACT. If I could harvest all my required seed by simply driving this tractor, I might be able to overcome my seasonal shortage of labour. With no bulky loads of straw to contend with, this could prove to be better than a forage harvester. But, again, nobody told me that Thinner seed, harvested in this manner in Adelaide Hills, has a very high dormancy. I don't recall finding even one seedling that resulted from that year's harvest. It is easy to see why some people get promoted and others don't. For the next season, the harvester underwent some very urgent modifications. Hero Rotary Rasp works in conjunction with the overhead reel to strip off thermal panicles, rather than just a pure seed to facilitate some measure of after-ripening of the seed. Although this ploy was partially successful in achieving some seed germination, it was not successful enough to redeem the harvester. In order to salvage the tractor, along with my own reputation, the harvester was replaced with a conventional hay mower and buck rake to once again harvest thimbler full-length corns, thereby restoring the previously successful establishment rate. The seemingly totally useless harvester got a reprieve when I discovered that it was very efficient in harvesting microlina seed. Seed that I was relieved to find did not have any problem with the dormancy. The same machine was also very useful in harvesting Rhytidosperma, wallaby grass. By now, the grass revegetation program was giving every indication of becoming a booming industry. And the board decided that I should trade their tractor in on a new one. Technology, it seems, is finally proving its worth. I was never very productive with a sickle, but here is a seed harvest from just 2 days of my time spent in the field with a harvester, something like 60 kilograms of florid seed. At this very critical phase of native grass propagation, I was actively involved with a newly established Native Grass Resources Group. Because my board had reneged on a commitment to a land care project it shared with the group, I resolved to tender my resignation from the board. Just so happened that the Animal Plant Control Commission conducted an audit of the board and advised it to make up a significant shortfall in my salary by giving me all of its equipment. At that time, this vibrating mesh seed cleaner was built with land care funding obtained by the Native Grass Resources Group to facilitate the production and use of native grass florid seed. Up until now, much of the florid seed I produced was sold off to other end users. But could I now value add this product by sowing it myself? Microlina is one seed that responds well to being broadcast over bare ground. The impact of rain on the exposed soil is usually sufficient to cover the seed. Here is my newly acquired tractor with microlina seed being mixed with sawdust and a Vicon spreader equipped with an extended agitator. However, non-selective herbicides can be used if the grass crop is confined to rows that can be shielded from the spray. This vibrating seed drill had reciprocating hoppers that delivered a mixture of seed and sawdust into furrows opened by sun-seeded discs. Seed had to be pre-mixed with moist sawdust. Its flow was not particularly reliable, and it was here that I first learned that seed germination could be very inconsistent. I've now decided to use something more mobile than a 4-ton tractor, and with this vehicle-mounted hydro seeder, the seed is mixed with water, thickened with a polymer where a positive displacement pump guarantees a prescribed application rate of seed per hectare. However, Working under a low pressure, this same unit is used to spray to grow weeds. But my mechanical requirements did nothing to improve seed germination rates. It was interesting to note that common wheatgrass sown over root zone of the eucalypts on the right had 20 times seed germination rate as that sown in the centre of the paddock. This seemingly ideal site turned out to be a failure simply because the presence or absence of soil microflora associated with the eucalypts was not able to assist plant establishment over the rest of the paddock. I've chosen this slide because it is an extreme example of what appears to be a very common problem. This paddock has been cropped or raised continuously for about 150 years and now suffers from very poor soil drainage. Repeated attempts to get native grass seeds to germinate in this soil, even on drier years, have met with repeated failure. Totally frustrated by my lack of success, I conducted a seed germination trial. The trial involved three 48-cell Avium trays containing my problem paddock soil. It was given various treatments. One rhizodisperma seed was sown in each cell, and a number of seeds germinating and dying recorded each day thereafter. In the first tray of untreated soil, 15 seeds germinated over a period of 28 days, of which only 5 of those seedlings survived. The second tray was inoculated with soil washings from an established rhizodisperma pasture. Here the germination rate almost doubled, but again, I still lost 2/3 of the seedlings. The third batch of soil was sterilised in a microwave oven and produced only average germination results, but my losses fell from 66% down to less than 10%. This suggests that poorly drained soil, particularly when supporting introduced grasses, contains pathogens that are harmful to native grass seedlings. In hindsight, I'm wondering what the results might have been had I inoculated the sterilised soil. Even if I do get good germination of seed, this is no guarantee that seed-free native grasses in particular are going to survive long term. This is a native grass seed orchard that had been recently sown in the Barossa, where competing weeds needed to be removed. A broad-spectrum herbicide in glyphosate can be used to safely take out the inter-row weeds, provided the operator is capable passing a very strict breathalyzer test. The sculpture mower employs a somewhat different strategy. It clips the native grass at an optimum height, encouraging it to develop a strong root system, while simultaneously mowing into row weeds very close to the ground to suppress their root development. The seed orchard is now sufficiently advanced to respond to treatment of the sculpture mower. With this equipment, any straying out of the windrow does not prove fatal to the native grass. Hopefully, there is still an opportunity to get it right next time. Objective achieved. We now have a mature, productive seed orchard free of any weeds that might contaminate the harvest. But a close look at the soil profile shows that we have a problem. The soil is sodic, and at the end of the winter, moisture only occupies the top 10 to 15 centimetre of the topsoil. Our seed orchard only survived for 5 years. This seemingly healthy and vigorous stand of rhizodisperma in Barossa vineyard, again, only lasted 5 years. This is another hydro unit that can now sow seed, but more importantly, can be used to apply aerobic compost tea. The vertical shaft engine on top of the unit provides agitation as well as a necessary constant aeration. Compost tea is made in a 200 litre container housed within sawdust insulation. A diaphragm air pump provides the necessary oxygen for the aerobic culture 24/7. Originally, some compost tea made from selected of straw was applied to bare ground under a couple of randomly selected vine rows in early October. It became very obvious later in the season that vines that had chloris growing in the midrow significantly outperformed mines that had no direct association with Torrens. Thereafter, any subsequent applications of compos have been applied directly to the Chloris. The three blue columns in this graph simply indicate the year when compost tea was applied to the vineyard. The red columns show the food yield of vines associated with chloris expressed as a percentage of the yield from a control where vines had no association with chloris. So you can see that in 2009, as in previous years, vines growing with chloris produced fruit that amounted to only 60% or less of the volume produced by vines in the control. But in 2011, in response to the compost tea, the vines with chloris trebled their normal fruit production and outproduced the control by almost 100%. However, since 2013, production relative to the control has fallen away, and unfortunately, I have no idea what has caused it. My brew seems to have lost its mojo, and I'm now desperately trying to find out why. I've made mention of my several involvements with soil microflora to indicate that the microbial world can have a profound effect, not only on the establishment of native grasses, but also on how those grasses can interact with other plants. It is here that I intend to get right away from sowing native grass seed. This is a vacant block where a notice was regularly served on the owner to carry out prescribed fuel reduction. Each year he chose to burn the block rather than have it slashed by council. This photo shows the result. Not one seed of native grass was sown on his block. Polaris abounds on the road verges of one chain roads around Dunkill, south of the Grampians. But on three chain roads, CFA conducts regular control burns to reduce the fuel loads. The result, heaven for native grass enthusiasts. Again, not one seed of native grass was sown to achieve this result. Another regular burnt site at Lenswood. And again, another familiar result. Dare I repeat myself? No native grass seed was sown on this site either. Fire is very effective in destroying soil organic carbon. If organic carbon from decomposing imported grasses has a negative effect on native species, its removal by fire could be very beneficial to the propagation of our indigenous grasses. But 30 years on, with the original owner having sold the property and no further burning being carried out, this is the result. Bulbous weeds and Sporaxis and Watsonia abound. You know, the tree roots are mainly on the surface of what appears to be a dysfunctional soil. Although fire is very effective in producing an immediate and favourable response from native grasses, I'm concerned that its ability to oxidise soil organic carbon may have a detrimental effect on the soil in the long term. Burning has not contributed to the sad state of this paddock, where another bulb plant in Guilford grass abounds. However, for many years there has been no recycling of organic carbon back into the soil. Interestingly, some native grasses are now recolonising the site. I have been trying to address a soil drainage problem on my own property by cutting a hay crop and leaving it to eventually decompose and return to the soil. This has produced very beneficial results on this previously waterlogged paddock shown in an earlier slide. However, a light stocking rate of just 24 steers on 60 acres for 12 months was sufficient to interrupt the carbon recycling process. This is the damage inflicted for a native perennial pasture. The one thing I've overlooked in my years of propagating native grasses is that they are a product of controlled burning. This year, instead of sowing native grass seed, I plan to use fire to stimulate the natural regeneration of my paddocks that I have observed elsewhere. However, mindful of the damage I can do to the soil, I plan to use this prototype machine that is about to be constructed over the next few weeks. It is a tractor-mounted mobile gas fraction burner that is fueled by the hydrocarbon gases in biomass ground charcoal. This process leaves no decomposing organic carbon introduced grasses to impede the native species. However, or hopefully, when native grasses begin to dominate, the burner will be tuned to leave a blend of organic carbon and charcoal to enhance the soil. Charcoal, being a recalcitrant form of carbon, will persist to help sustain the organic process that I desperately need to refurbish my soils. Now, this may be a resounding success. Or being a gas-fired machine, it could literally blow up in my face. Either way, my unfortunate ability to entertain can only get better. Needs a good root system,
yep.
And if we encourage native grasses to develop a good healthy root system, they tend to compete with the other plants by grabbing more moisture anyway. They can sort of almost outcompete just by depriving competition with no moisture, or depriving of moisture. And let's grow the native grasses as best as we can. The competing plants, which are in between the rows of native grasses, well, let's do the opposite. Let's cut them back real short. Which means that their root system will shrink to a certain degree, and they'll find it very difficult then to compete with the natives. So here, just creating a favourable balance, or a balance in favour of the native grasses over the exotics. Pretty simple.
And that's one thing that I think, by doing broad-based mowing, you are going to deplete carbohydrates in those perennial grasses, don't you, in a way, at certain times, like, say, for radiosperm now. If you cut it down, a lot of the carbohydrates reserves are in not just in going into the column, into a growing like an annual exotic, but it's actually going to sort of reside in the leaf blades, and then is that something you sort of I'm on the right track, or
I've just lost your track?
Oh, just about annual exotic will set up a big seed, it's got all the carbohydrates that goes in the inner sperm, and it's there because nothing else is going to live. After it dries out, that's what's going to persist. As a seed, and by sort of allowing the if you cut certain seed tree grasses, I suppose, down to they then, because they're a perennial, a lot of them are perennial, that they are not putting their carbohydrates in that seed, they're putting it into leaf area and in roots as they get deeper, and those sort of things. I suppose by sculpting, you are sort of keeping the carbohydrate reserves that they need to go to for respiration in the dormancy period when it's hot, and they can then have to respire. Because they're not really growing,
they're not. I probably didn't get that fancy in my calculation. I was very basic. And it's really the root of the roots I was aiming at. Big roots for the perennials, natives, and very shallow roots for the exotics, be they perennial or annual. Mm. And just doing that does seem to work.
Yes?
Probably more of a comment than a question. I come from southwest Victoria, and I've been anecdotally, what we've seen is those three chain roads.
Dunkeld area?
Yep. They're generally strategic guide roads, and they're burned on an annual basis.
Right in the middle of summer, I noticed when I was down there.
Yeah, sometimes it rains, obviously volunteer based. But what we've found is the frequent fires actually benefit the kangaroo grass, but not the wallaby and spear grasses. So you find all those three chain roads are wall-to-wall kangaroo grass. So just a comment that fire's a great tool, but if it's too frequent, you'll knock a lot of those finer grasses out, particularly your wallabies.
I'd love to get back there for a holiday just before my talk to see what's actually happened down there. Yeah. So what's been the long-term result of the fire? Is it them dominating still?
Yes, it is.
these E3s are going back to. Okay.
Thank you. Yes.
The deposition of the exotic grass slash on the soil, you were saying that you thought it would do, or didn't encourage good mycorrhizal or soil micro.
That is something I've been slow to learn, but I've without panic about that. Oh God, that's not a well, it should be a well-drained slope, but it's not. Just it's absolutely mud puddle.
With the grazing pressure you had on it, that would have been taking a fair bit of that material away.
That was a problem.
Yeah.
As I see it, because what I've done previously is actually even we had a big crop of Phalaris part of the property. I actually cut that, put it on that paddock, just on the small size, to see what would happen. Mm. What you get is not Phalaris necessarily growing, but any sort of associated introduced grass, be it annual or whatever, seem to come up in its place. There's some sort of association between exotic grasses. They all seem to look after each other. I've even put it out in the vineyard and actually decimated my native grass by putting some of this on top. So the organic carbon from exotic species seems to be a real impediment to native grasses.
You're thinking of biochar, that carbon source, but even more degraded form would be a lot better.
Well, biochar is not organic carbon as such. The microbes can't degrade it. It's very recalcitrant. So you're not getting the same effect from biochar. It's purely carbon because it's not going to be broken down and facilitate the...
That was the last bit of equipment you showed here. That was going to produce biochar.
Yeah, that's the idea of it. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. We'll get to make it improve the paddock here.
Well, hopefully we see you in a couple of years then.
Very good, fantastic, thank you.